one formula rules them all, right? And so we call it finding order in seeming chaos. The coefficient, if you take the coefficient of the this power of q in this infinite series, then it will give you exactly this AP, which is p minus number of solutions for all primes, for all primes. And so what happens is a kind of a colossal compression of information, because just one, think about just one line of code, and I explained how this to produce this code, right? So it's there's some regularity here. You don't need infinite amount of information, it's finite amount of information. You just say 1 minus q to the I, where I is equal to 1, and then repeat for I plus 1. So you analyze q squared times q squared square, and each time square it, right? So this term. And then do the same with q to the 11 instead of q. So q to the 11, q to the 22, q to the 33. It's easy to program. It's extremely easy to program it on the computer in such a way that for any prime number that is accessible, that you have access to on your computer, in your hard drive or your memory, that you can actually store it, you can find in finite amount of time the coefficient in front of q to the p. And guess what? It's going to be exactly the number of solutions. Well, more precisely, it's going to be p minus the number of solutions for that cubic equation. That's an example of the Langlands program. And it's the most beautiful. It's the simplest, most beautiful example. I have to say, I learned it from Richard Taylor. He's a great mathematician. He's at the Institute for Advanced Study. He was a co-author of Andrew Wiles in their famous paper, Solving Fermat's Last Theorem. So I learned an example from him, actually. And it's in my book as well. It's in Love and Math, in chapter 7, I think. So if you want to learn more about this, kind of slow reading, that's where you can find it. So
I also recommend that book just for people who are listening. I read it approximately a year ago or so. And in one of the early chapters, you cover braid groups and knot theory, right, which is something you learn in third year in university, mm-hmm. but it's covered in one of the early chapters.
That was my first mathematical work. That's why I talk about it, right? So that was my first excitement of solving something which nobody knew, making discovery. We talked about whether mathematics discovered or invented. Certainly in that moment, I felt like I discovered something, you mm-hmm. know, about braid groups. But anyway, so what I'm trying to say is that this just one line of code kind of gives us a simple rule for solving this infinite counting problem for all prime numbers at once. That's what I mean by finding hidden connections. Remember, I said, to me, unification in mathematics is about finding hidden connections between different fields, which seem to be far apart. Here, it's between the field of number theory and the field of harmonic analysis. All right. So now let's talk about what is this product? Okay. In what sense does it reside in harmonic analysis? Okay. And so the point is that when we talked about it first, we talked about it as a kind of a formal expression. Right? So just like product Q. So Q was just a variable. But actually, it turns out that we can assign a numerical value to Q, and this product will converge. So even though it is a product of infinitely many numbers, it turns out that this product actually makes sense. And not in a kind of a esoteric sense, it's like 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4, but actually like the rigid, precise, rigorous sense of limits that we study in calculus. The product of finitely many terms of this from the first to the nth of this expression is actually going to have a limit as n goes to infinity. And that, therefore, but only if q is a number between minus 1 and 1, a real number between minus 1 and 1. Or we could also work with a complex unit disk. You know, the complex numbers live on a plane because they have both real and imaginary part. And every complex number has a norm, which is the distance from this, from a geometric representation of this number as a point on a complex plane and the point zero. So for example, number I has norm one, because that's the distance from I to zero. If you take all numbers whose norm is less than one, you obtain the interior of a disk, of a unit disk, right? And for every point in that disk, if you view it as a complex number and substitute in this infinite expression, we will get a well-defined number. It will have a limit. This product will have a limit, you see. So therefore, we get a function on the unit disk. For every Q, we get a specific value, which is encoded by this infinite product. So we get a function on the unit disk, and it is called a modular form. And the point is that it has very special transformation properties under the group of symmetries of the unit disk, which is denoted PSL2Z. So instead of explaining exactly how this group acts on the unit disk, I'm going to show you how a similar group acts by showing you the what's called the fundamental domains. So the action of a group like this, it's actually going to be a subgroup of PSL2Z. This is not exactly the same subgroup, but it will do as an illustration. So here's what I'm talking about. Remember our harmonic analysis on the circle, which we...
Wait, can you go back just a moment? Can you go back to slide 40? Okay, so this function is defined on the complex unit disk.
Yes, which is, think about this. It's like this, right? So two complex numbers.
To all of complex numbers.
That's right. So
not
look,
just upper
so,
half plane.
So look, here's a complex plane, which has two axes, x and y, where if you have a point here, a point with coordinates x, y, we assign to it number x plus yi. That's a complex number assigned to a point, right? And so you have number one here, you have number I here, you have number minus one here, you have number minus I here. And then you can draw this circle of radius one. And so your number Q is going to be some number inside this circle, you see. So that's your Q. The condition is that Q is less than one, which means that x squared plus y squared is less than one. Does it make sense?
My question is, where is it going to? What's the target space?
Oh yeah, so for every Q, which is like this, this function has a value which is a complex number without any restrictions.
Okay.
Some complex number.
And it's unique?
It's unique, yes. It's unique, absolutely. Yes, otherwise it's not a function, right? So when we say function, we mean single-valued function, which means a rule which assigns to every Q some complex number. But every Q, not everywhere. Uh-huh. Q is constrained by the property that it is within the unit disk. The value is, the only constraint is that it's unique, is finite, it's well-defined, and it's uniquely defined. So
and now explain where SL2Z comes in.
So SL2Z, yes, so there is a SL2Z. Before I explain this, let's look at a simpler situation. Okay, so at a simpler example, namely the harmonic analysis that we discussed earlier when we talked about sounds of music, right? So we have this basic harmonics, sine nx and cosine nx, where n is an integer. And we discussed the fact that every function on the circle, so they are periodic functions, because if you send x plus x to pi, the value will be the same. So they're periodic with period 2 pi, right? And the point is, so they're invariant under the shift x plus 2 pi. And the point is that harmonic analysis allows us to write any function on the circle, essentially, any continuous function, let's say, as a linear combination of these guys. That's called Fourier series. And you can think about it as a decomposing the sound of a symphony, of an orchestra, into the notes of different instruments in time. So that in this case, the X is a time, because it plays in music in time. And each note, roughly speaking, is a wave, like sine of an X or cosine of an X. And as I said, we can arrange things in such a way that these notes have approximately proportional to a specific note. To a specific frequency. The frequencies of these notes are proportional to a specific frequency with integer multiple, with rational multiples more precisely, but we can always find a kind of a common denominator so that they will be just integer multiples. So that's the setup of harmonic analysis. But what I want to focus our attention on is the fact that actually there is this invariance. What's special about these functions, sine nx and cosine nx, is that they are invariant under the shift. X goes to x plus 2 pi. But if so, it's also invariant under the shift x plus 2 pi times some integer. For example, 4 pi, 6 pi, 8 pi, yes. Minus 2 pi, and so on. So you see what happens, that actually there is a group of symmetries that is lurking in the background when you talk about these functions. This function really is defined, think about it, this function is defined on the real line. So that's your real line, right? And so your function is going to be a cosine function or sine function. So it's going to look something like this, right? It's a wave like this. But now the point is that if you shift it, you see, if you shift it by this amount, if you shift it by this amount, it will stay the same, right? So if you imagine shifting this whole curve from here to here, so this point goes to here, this point goes to here, so it will go to itself. That's what I mean by being invariant, right?
I think that's the best approach for this part. And then in part two, we can go to the graduate student level.
Yeah, I do. I want people to understand it because it's really basic and beautiful stuff. So what I'm trying to say is that there is a shift under which the whole thing goes to itself.
Yes.
And so this shift is a shift by 2 pi. Let's say that I'm writing the basic one, which corresponds to n equal 1. And then the sine 2xa, they will oscillate more frequently, but they will still be invariant under this shift. But it's also invariant under the shift by 4 pi. It's also invariant under the shift by 4 pi, which would be like twice this. Twice. You do this and one more time, right? So as a result, it's invariant under all of the shifts. And all of the shifts gives you an action of the group of integers on the real line. And what I would like to focus on is what's called the fundamental domain of this action. And the fundamental domain of this action is just this interval. Because it's like, remember, like when we talked about arithmetic modulo 5, then we identify things which are related by a multiple of 5. So the fundamental domain consists of just 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Every other thing you can get by adding to one of those a multiple of 5. And likewise now, on this picture, every real number can be obtained from a number on just on this interval plus a multiple of 2 pi. So that's called the fundamental domain. Fundamental domain. But actually, it's not the only fundamental domain. The whole real line breaks into fundamental domains, which are going to be from this point to this point, from this point to the next, and so on. They all have lengths 2 pi. And now let's go back to this. So here on the unit disk, there is another group, which is called PSL2C, which plays the role of Z, 2 pi Z, in our baby version, which is here.
Right.
This 2 pi m. And the analogs of these intervals are precisely this kind of hyperbolic triangles, both red and white. So this gives you a sense of how this group acts. It acts by hyperbolic transformations. And this visualizes what it does, it exchanges different triangles. It exchanges points in red triangles with points in other red triangles or white triangles, you see. So this gives you a rough idea of the special properties of this function that we are considering. This function, which is obtained from our infinite series that solved for us all the counting problems for all prime numbers all at once, this function that we obtained from this series by evaluating it at points in the unit disk actually has special symmetry properties with respect to the group which acts like so, which is similar to how sine and cosine functions act with respect to the action of a much simpler group, namely the group 2 pi z, z being the integers. You see? So that's a rough explanation. And again, if you want to know more, for instance, you can read about this in chapter 7 of Love and Math and so on. But that's a kind of a rough explanation of what is so special about this function.
Now, the weight in this one is what? Is 2, you said here, or is it 1? The weight, because modular forms
weight
have
two.
A weight.
Weight is 2. Weight is 2, because, roughly speaking, because, well, it's an elliptic, so it's like, it has to do something two-dimensional is in the background.
Sure.
Now, this is actually, so now, this is one example, remember. What we're considering is just one example. There is one counting problem. There is a specific cubic equation, right? It was y squared plus y equals x cubed minus x. And we are looking for every prime number, we get a number of solutions, and then we slightly modify it by subtracting it from p.
Okay.
Those are coefficients in front of prime powers of q in this infinite series. Can we generalize it? It turns out that this has a vast generalization.
In other words, you were just given an elliptic equation so that y cubed minus y squared equals x cubed or whatever
That's
it was
right.
before.
That's right.
Okay, so you were given an equation. Then you, from that, asked, well, what are the number of solutions in modulo prime or the clock arithmetic prime number?
That's right.
And then actually you took a modified form of that with some error term, but it doesn't matter.
That's right.
Found a correspondence between that and a modular form.
That's right.
Now you're wondering...
A specific modular form, right? Which we could actually write out explicitly.
Right. And now you're wondering, okay, well, that was for one elliptic curve. Can I be greedy? Is there a class of elliptic curves that this may work on? Oh, does it work for every single
exactly.
type of elliptic curve?
Exactly. Every smooth...
Is there something special here?
It actually works for all smooth elliptic curves. So there is some kind of condition, non-degenerate kind of equations, okay? So there are lots of equations you can write of this nature that we wrote, right? Infinitely many, in fact. And for all of them, there will be its own, for each of them, there will be its own modular form, which will encode numbers of solutions for all primes, save maybe finitely many. In this case, we lucked out actually every single prime. For every single prime, we got matching, perfect matching with the coefficients. In general, there will be finitely many prime numbers for which it will not work. But okay, it's not a big deal compared to infinity of other primes for which it will work, you see.
If you enjoyed this Toe clipping, then the full video is linked in the description. You should also sign up for Toe Mail, which is again in the description and the pinned comment. You'll receive immediate access to all exclusive updates from the Theories of Everything podcast. It also helps me communicate directly with the core Toe community. You'll also receive my top 10 Toes. Think of it as the intellectual version of Quentin Tarantino's obsession.